ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. टुडे इज द सीक्रेट जन्मतिथि ऑफ स्वामी शिवानंद जी, वन ऑफ द डायरेक्ट डिसाइपल्स ऑफ श्री रामकृष्ण एंड द सेकेंड प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द रामकृष्ण ऑर्डर. Let us reflect on his life and his teachings in brief. Shivananji was born to a devout couple. His father, Ram Kanai Ghoshal, was an ardent devotee of the Divine Mother and practiced Tantra Sadhana. His mother, Vamasundari, was a devout lady. The couple prayed to Tarakeshwar Shiva for a son. In a dream, Vamasundari had a vision of Lord Shiva, who told her, "I am pleased with your devotion, I bless you. You will be the mother of a spiritual son." This son was born on 16th November 1854 and was named Taraknath Ghoshal. Unfortunately, Taraknath's mother passed away when he was just 9 years old, and then his elder sister too died. As if this was not enough, his second sister became a widow. These developments sowed the seeds of renunciation in Taraknath. From his boyhood, Taraknath had a keen desire to experience and be immersed in samadhi. The meditative pose of Lord Shiva and Bhagavan Buddha was very dear to him, and he would spend nights weeping and praying to God with deep yearning. But he had to marry against his wishes because it was an exchange marriage to help his youngest sister. He married his brother-in-law's sister, and so his father did not have to pay any dowry. But Taraknath guided his wife in leading a spiritual life and did not have any physical relationship with her. Eventually, his wife passed away within a year. And later, much later, when Swami Vivekananda came to know of this brahmacharya practiced in a marriage relationship, he said it was characteristic of a Mahapurusha, and that Shivananji was indeed a Mahapurush. From then on, Swami Shivananji came to be known as Mahapurush Maharaj. Going back, Taraknath met Sri Ramakrishna for the first time in mid-1880. And next month he went to Dakshineshwar, and in the very first interaction, he felt a deep attraction for Sri Ramakrishna. He saw his own mother in Sri Ramakrishna and surrendered at his feet. During his second or third visit, Sri Ramakrishna, through a touch, sent Taraknath into a deep meditative state, which revealed to Sri Ramakrishna the deep truths about Taraknath's life. Taraknath was first among the disciples to renounce worldly attachments and stay mostly with Sri Ramakrishna during the last three years of his life. He was also among those who served Sri Ramakrishna during his last illness at Kasipur. Taraknath practiced severe austerities under the guidance of Sri Ramakrishna. In mid-January 1886, Sri Ramakrishna gave 12 pieces of ochre cloth and rosaries among his disciples, and Taraknath was one of them. Later, after the Mahasamadhi of Sri Ramakrishna, in December 1886, Taraknath and other young brother disciples took the informal vows of sannyasa, and a month later they formally took the monastic vows, and Narendranath, that is the later Swami Vivekananda, gave Taraknath the name Swami Shivananda, recognizing his Shiva-like nature. After this, for over a decade, Mahapurush Maharaj travelled across India, visiting Tirtha Kshetras in the Himalayas, Central India and South India. He roamed across the plains, deserts and forests, depending solely on God. And the Himalayas especially had a deep attraction for him. Swami Vivekananda urged his brother disciples to go forward from seeking and remaining absorbed in the Atman and serve the same Atman in all beings. Atmano mokshartham jagat hitaya cha. This was the motto he gave to the Ramakrishna order. Mahapurush Maharaj was one of the first direct disciples to understand Swamiji's idea and respond wholeheartedly to it. Mahapurush Maharaj was a great mystic. There is one incident, among many, we can recollect one. He was then staying in Varanasi, and one morning he told the gathered sannyasis, "Look, I had a very delightful experience last night. In the dead of night, I suddenly saw before me a divine figure of white complexion with matted hair and three eyes. His luminous form lighted up the whole place. Oh, what a beautiful, lovely, compassionate face! The vision roused my spiritual energy upward, and my whole being was gradually absorbed in divine bliss. Then that form gradually vanished, and in its place stood Sri Ramakrishna with a smiling face. Pointing to me, the master said, 'You will have to live a little longer, for you still have something more to do.' As Thakur said this, my mind came down to the normal plane and the body began functioning as usual. Sri Ramakrishna is none other than Vishwanath himself." Then a curious sannyasi asked, "Did you have the vision in a dream?" Master Mahesha replied, "No, no, I was wide awake." In 1922, after the Mahasamadhi of Swami Brahmananji, Mahapurush Maharaj became the president of the Ramakrishna order and continued in that capacity for 12 years until his Mahasamadhi. In this period, he met countless devotees and sannyasis, listened to their problems and guided them in their spiritual practices. Mahapurush Maharaj would meditate for long hours both in morning and evening. Once an attendant asked why he needed to meditate so much when he could have the vision of God and even talk with him. Mahapurush Maharaj replied, "Yes, my child, you have spoken rightly. Without any effort on my part, the Lord graciously appears to me and if necessary speaks to me. I do not meditate for that reason, but for this. Many have had initiation from me, but not all can keep up their spiritual practices. There are still others who, although they keep up their practices, do not make much headway because of certain obstructions in their lives. For them, I have to pray separately. When I concentrate a little, their faces flash across my mind, and I pray for them individually. I have to remove the obstructions that stand in the way of their spiritual progress. Besides, in the world, many have trials and tribulations. I have to help them also. It is the Lord who inspires me from within to do these things. In the world, there is no end to troubles. Consequently, my only prayer is that there may be peace everywhere, with a lessening of pain and sorrow, and that men may advance towards God. I do not perform spiritual practices for myself, my child." That was Mahapurush Maharaj's sadhana as the guru of the Sangha. His nirabhimanitva is another aspect of his personality. One day, after making pranams to Sri Ramakrishna in the shrine, a young devotee came down the steps and saw that a dog had defecated on the veranda of the main monastery building and it had not come to anyone's notice. Then he saw a senior Swami scoop it up in a piece of paper and give it to this devotee who was standing nearby, saying, "Please throw this away in the gutter by the side of the Ganga." Later he came to know this was the direct disciple, Swami Shivananda. He did not wait to tell some junior monk or a brahmachari or a servant, "Please come and clean this place." When he saw it, his first response was to clean it, not ask someone else to clean it. Mahapurush Maharaj would often tell the sadhus and devotees, quote, "See, this mutt belongs to Thakur. Thakur is ever present here. Everyone should pay particular attention to see that no filth is found lying about anywhere. Thakur did not like uncleanliness or untidiness at all." One of the Swamis was fortunate to come in contact and live for some time with Swami Shivananji was Swami Pavitrananda. In his reminiscences, he writes, "It was a summer afternoon. Mahapurush Maharaj just woke up from his noon rest, but he was still lying on his bed. Pavitrananji went in and started fanning him. All of a sudden, a middle-aged man entered the room. Actually, at that time, in that hour, no visitors were allowed in the Belumat. But this man somehow had come inside and come to the president's room, personal room. This man's hair was disheveled and his appearance indicated that he was a disturbed person. Coming near the bed of Mahapurush Maharaj, he abruptly asked, 'Why is there so much suffering in the world?' Mahapurush Maharaj slowly got up from his bed and went to his chair near the table. The visitor sat on the floor. Mahapurush Maharaj bent towards him and with very deep sympathy said in a soft voice, 'I do not know what is the cause of misery in the world. I can say how one can get out of it.'" The words were laden with such great eagerness to help the disturbed person that the visitor soon became calm and soothed. Two youngsters once came and asked Mahapurush Maharaj, "We have made Sri Ramakrishna our life's ideal and are trying to shape our lives according to his ideas. We pray for your help in this matter. You are one of Sri Ramakrishna's foremost disciples. Please give us some light." Mahapurush Maharaj's reply is very enlightening. He told those young men, "My boys, you are blessed that you have made Sri Ramakrishna your life's ideal. I bless you with all my heart that you may gain in strength and become even more blessed. May you attain the consummation of your life's ideal. The light you refer to will come from within. The more you try to enter within, reaching the inner and innermost recesses of your heart, the greater the light you will receive. The mother, the embodiment of light, is within every heart. She is within me, she is within you, she is everywhere, in everything, from Brahman down to the smallest insect, in the movable and the immovable. Pray to Mahamaya, the firstborn. She holds the key in her hands. The realm of light will be opened unto you if she graciously unlocks the door. She alone is the source of the entire universe. We have all come from that mother and will eventually merge in her again. That primordial energy, the power of Brahman, is beyond the reach of this mind and intellect of ours. She manifests herself in a pure mind. Man cannot reach or understand her through spiritual practice alone. She is self-luminous. It is her consciousness that makes this world conscious. Hold on to that mother. She is within yourself. It is she who will open the way to the light." Then the youngsters again asked another question. Please tell us a little of what you learned by your lifelong spiritual practice and open the way to light by blessing us. Mahapurush Maharaj replied, I told you, my boys, this light is within yourself. Dive deep within and you will discover. You will discover the light. That is the essence of all teachings. Be resigned unto the mother. Pray to her earnestly, crying like a child, and you will discover the light. You will see that the blissful mother will give you joy and peace. She will certainly do so. Another Swami, Swami Akshayananda, has very interesting reminiscence. He writes, an old fisherman used to cast his net from his boat near the mud bathing ghat, and Mahapurush Maharaj would help him in various ways. For some days the fisherman did not bring his boat to the ghat. So Mahapurush Maharaj told Akshayananda, ah, he is an old man, who knows what has happened to him? Go and inquire about him. Akshayananda asked, where is his house? Mahapurush Maharaj replied, it is in the Bali area. You go there and search a little, you will find him. Next day at the fisherman's village, Akshayananji somehow met the fisherman's sister. And he came to know the old fisherman had died, his wife had no support, and they were in utter poverty. When he heard this, Mahapurush Maharaj immediately sent some money saying, go and give her this money right away and find out when the funeral ceremony will begin. After that, Mahapurush Maharaj would occasionally send Akshayananda to give money to the fisherman's family. There are some more anecdotes like this which speak about his heart, his love and his compassion for the suffering mankind. There was the daughter of a devotee who had recently married, and that devotee one day came to Belur Math just before Durga Puja. When he offered his pranams to Mahapurush Maharaj, Maharaj asked him about many things. Then he asked, how is your daughter? The devotee replied, she is all right, just recently married. Mahapurush Maharaj said, the puja is coming, Durga Puja. Will you be sending any gifts in honor of the marriage? Then the devotee replied, I won't be able to send anything this year. I have lost my job. Mahapurush Maharaj replied, how is that? She has just gone to her mother-in-law's house. What will people say if you don't give anything? Your daughter will be made to feel very much ashamed in her new home. This was a father's concern which Mahapurush Maharaj is expressing. To this the devotee replied, but I have no money. At that Mahapurush Maharaj asked, what is the smallest amount required to send a gift? The devotee answered, the least it can be done for is 60 rupees. Mahapurush Maharaj said, all right, take 60 rupees and send something. To this the devotee replied, how can I take your money? Then immediately Mahapurush Maharaj said, what is that? You are all Thakur's devotees. You are our very own. When he heard this, the devotee began to weep out of joy and gratitude. There is another story. This is about an attorney. He was living nearby, a place called Lilua, near Belur Math. He was fighting a case for Belur Math in the court. So in that connection, he would come to the mat now and then. But he would not go to the shrine and he would not offer pranams to any sadhus. But he also would not take any fee for his professional contribution. One day he came, he went to see Mahapurush Maharaj, his face was downcast, he appeared to be very terribly in depression. So Mahapurush Maharaj asked him, what is the matter, why are you like this? Then that attorney started speaking. He had lost everything. All his savings had gone. All his movable properties were gone because he was under deep debt and he had to repay it. And only his home was left, and that too would be auctioned off the next day. And he told Mahapurush Maharaj, "Not one of my friends has helped me." Mahapurush Maharaj felt very sorry for him and said, "Then where will you go with your wife and children? How much will the house be auctioned for?" The attorney replied, 4,000 rupees. Hearing that, Mahapurush Maharaj said with utmost sympathy, "Take the money from me and buy back your house." The attorney was stunned. He replied, "But how can I take and how shall I repay you?" Mahapurush Maharaj said with great affection, "You are one of my very own. Why do you worry about that?" We should understand this is almost 90 years ago, 4,000 rupees. Mahapurush Maharaj is offering to the attorney. He is not even a devotee. He is just giving his legal services free. Sometime in 1922, 4 or 5 months after the Mahasamadhi of Swami Brahmananji, Mahapurush Maharaj was then the new president of the Ramakrishna Order. A high-ranking government officer came to see Mahapurush Maharaj. Then he told his sad story. He had requested Brahmananji to give him Mantra Diksha, and Brahmananji had told him, as he would often do, "Prepare yourself for it, let me see later." Maharaj would give guidance about what kind of life should be led, and if that candidate was sincere and if he would live by that for 1 or 2 years, only then Brahmananji would give the Mantra Diksha. But unfortunately, Brahmananji attained Mahasamadhi and this man was distraught. And he had come to Mahapurush Maharaj because some new development had happened. He says he was very much upset, and so he prayed earnestly to Sri Ramakrishna, and 3 days before coming he had a vision of Brahmananji where Brahmananji gave him Mantra Diksha. But unfortunately, when this man woke up, he could not recollect the mantra fully. He tried very hard but he could not remember, and from that moment he was feeling terrible. "I prayed to Brahmananji, he could not give me Diksha, but now he came and gave me Mantra Diksha in a dream and I have forgotten it." So finding no other way out, he came to Belur Math with the firm conviction that the present president, Swami Shivananji, will be able to help him. And as he said this, the man started piteously crying. Now Mahapurush Maharaj listened to the devotee with all attention, and seeing the yearning of the devotee, Mahapurush Maharaj's face became radiant with compassion. He again consoled the man, saying, "Since Maharaj, that is Swami Brahmananji, has shown so much kindness to you, you need not have any fear. His grace will make everything all right. Don't be despondent. When the proper time arrives, he will reveal himself to you again and bless you. Go on calling on him with all earnestness." But this did not give any consolation to the devotee. He again and again pressed Mahapurush Maharaj, "Please give me initiation." Then Mahapurush Maharaj asked the devotee to wait for some time, and he entered the room where Brahmananji used to live, and he closed the door behind him. The things that Brahmananji had used when he was alive, they were arranged in that room as when he was alive, and offerings were daily made before a picture. So there was a very strong presence of Brahmananji in that room. Mahapurush Maharaj went in, and after about half an hour, he opened the door and asked the devotee to enter the room. And the devotee went inside, the door was closed. And after some time, Mahapurush Maharaj alone came out and sat quietly on his bed. The devotee came out after 1 hour and offering Sashtang Pranam to Mahapurushji, he He said, "My life is blessed today. You have given me the very same mantra that Raja Maharaj gave me in my dream. This has delighted me very much. I have directly perceived that he resides in you. Kindly bless me that I may realize my chosen deity, Ishtadevata, even in this life." Then Mahapurush Maharaj blesses him and gives instructions which are very much relevant even today and specially useful for us as sadhakas. Mahapurush Maharaj tells him, "You are indeed very fortunate. Maharaj is so kind to you and he is helping you in so many ways. Just because you earned so much merit in your previous life. Now engage yourself in spiritual practices with the help of the valuable gift you have received and you will have your desire fulfilled. A true devotee relies on the Lord under all circumstances like a kitten on its mother. He calls on him with tears and prays to him with all humility. He alone knows when to grant the vision of himself to the devotee. Take refuge in him and keep waiting at his door, praying all the while with heart and soul for full faith, devotion and love. He will fill your heart to the brim." Then the devotee asked, "Please teach me a little how I should meditate and make japa. I have to remain ever engrossed in my worldly duties. Besides, the responsibilities of my post are very exacting. Kindly bless me that I may become free from these bondages so as to be able to call on God." To this Mahapurush Maharaj replies, "As for our blessing, it is always there to be sure. You too have to engage yourself in spiritual practices with determination. Go on making regular japa of the mantra you have received today. And along with japa, pray with all humility, 'Lord, bless me so that I may meditate on you and so that my mind may lose itself at your lotus feet.' And he is sure to do so, rest assured. He is the guru in everybody's heart, the guide, master, father, mother, friend, in fact everything to a man. All for whom people cry in this world, thinking they are their own, will live only for a few days. The eternal companion is he alone. Go on repeating his name with full sincerity, and you will find that meditation will follow as a natural development. Go on repeating his name with full sincerity, and you will find that meditation will follow as a natural development. When one goes on repeating the name of the chosen deity, Ishtadevata, with intense love, one becomes gradually filled with an ineffable bliss. When that bliss becomes continuous, it is also a kind of meditation. Meditations are of various kinds. Go on meditating on the blessed, effulgent form of the Lord with the greatest love. And imagine that every recess of your heart shines with the light emanating from his form. As you go on thinking thus, you will feel that your whole being becomes suffused with inexpressible joy. Gradually, the form also will get dissolved, and you will have the feeling of a kind of bliss associated with consciousness. This also is a kind of meditation. There are innumerable other kinds of meditation which you will yourself come to know by stages. The main thing that counts is to call on him with all sincerity. As you go on calling on him and weeping for him, all the dirt in your mind will be washed away and it will become purified. Then that pure mind itself will act as guru to you. You will get all the answers from within yourself to all the questions that you may have about what you need at a particular time, how you should meditate, how you should call on him, and all such things. You must have read what the master used to say. The breeze of divine grace is blowing all the time, it is for you to unfurl your sail. This unfurling of the sail means undertaking spiritual practices with sincere diligence. He is ever eager to bestow His grace, just as a mother keeps her hands always ready to take up the child to her lap. Do try a bit, and then only will you feel how compassionate He is. Then the devotee says, I cannot always understand how I should live in the world. It is a terrible task ever to be pandering to everybody's whims around us. Mahapurushji replies, have you read the Kathamrita of the Master? Read it very carefully. You will get beautiful solution to these problems in the very words of the Master. This world is neither yours nor mine. It is God's creation. Those whom you think to be yours really belong to God. You have to live in this world with this belief as the background. Wife, son, daughter, relatives, friends, all are but so many creatures of God. Whatever you have to do for them, do so with the idea that you are serving Narayana in those forms. Then you won't get attached too much. And along with all this, you must have your power of discrimination wide awake. The discrimination between the real and the unreal gives rise to detachment. You are leading a householder's life. Very well. But that is no reason why you should lose yourself in the world. Do your duty by all, but do so with the idea of it as service to God. The Lord is infinitely kind to you. Thousands there are who have to run madly after food and raiment. They are so much occupied with the thoughts of the bare necessities of life that they hardly get any time to think of God. But you do not have to worry about these physical needs. There is no inconsiderable mercy of God. God creates all the necessary opportunities for those who are sincere devotees. When all fall asleep at dead of night, rise up to call on Him with your whole being and become one with Him. Tell Him of the yearning of your heart with tears in your eyes. Midnight is the best time for spiritual practices. You have the auspicious signs of a man of spirituality. You are bound to succeed. That is why I am talking thus to you. Be up and doing at the beginning, and you will find that your whole being will be filled with an ineffable joy. You will lose yourself in the current of that inebriating bliss. Can there be any comparison of that with the hollow joys of this world? Then the devotee asks, should I keep count when making japa? Kindly tell me what should be the number of times I should repeat that mantra and how I should do it. To this Mahapurush Maharaj replies, japa can be performed in three ways, with the help of a rosary, counting on the beads, or mentally. Mental japa is the best. Tulsidas said, one who tells his beads is vulgar. One who repeats the mantra with the help of his finger is commendable. But the highest praise goes to one who does it all mentally. If one cultivates the habit of making japa mentally, one can go on doing it at all times and under all circumstances, even while moving about, eating or lying down in bed. When this becomes a firm habit, it will continue even during sleep and generate a current of joy in the mind. But in the beginning, it is good to fix a definite number for the daily japa. You should sit for japa with steadfastness at least twice a day, morning and evening, and repeat the mantra for a definite number of times. It should not be less than 1,000 each time in your case. If you can increase that number, it will be still better. You can keep count with the help of a rosary or on your fingers. Saying this, Mahapurush Maharaj showed how to keep count on the fingers. Thakur used to say that the name and the being named are one and the same. As you repeat the mantra of the Ishtadevata, think of his form as well. Thus you can have both japa and meditation simultaneously. God dwells in the heart, and he sees how earnest one is in calling on him. He does not care for either the number or the time. To call on him even once only with a sincere mind is more effective than making the japa of a mantra for 100,000 times with an unsteady mind. What is wanted is intensity, yearning and sincerity. Once you have the yearning in your mind, success is near at hand. All this does not happen in a single day. Persist in your efforts with determination, and everything will come about in due course. And come to Belumath now and then. Many sannyasis live here. You should associate with them. Even the sight of holy men generates thoughts about God in one's heart. This is an idea that Swami Shivananji often presented to the devotees. We'll conclude with his address to the devotees of Chennai Math, which he delivered in April 1924. He told the devotees of Chennai Math, "You all are householder children of Thakur. You will have to take the great responsibility of spreading his name and message throughout the world. It is for the good of the many that Thakur Sri Ramakrishna has been established in the mutt here. Now making him the center, you should build up your spiritual life by worship, japa, meditation and service-oriented activities. Sri Ramakrishna is God himself. Although he is omnipresent and dwells in the hearts of all, he has especially manifested himself in this mutt to bless his devotees." He told Swami Vivekananda, "I will go and leave wherever it will be your pleasure to take me, carrying me on your shoulders, be it under a tree or in the humblest cottage." That is why Swami Vivekananda established him at Belumath for the spiritual welfare of the whole world. Since everyone doesn't get an opportunity to go to Belumath, the sannyasis of the Ramakrishna order have built ashramas in various places and established Sri Ramakrishna there. By this, as well as by their own lives, dedicated to spiritual practices, they try to help others lead a spiritual life. As there is a special manifestation of Sri Ramakrishna here, know this to be a very holy place. Sri Ramakrishna is very fond of his devotees and can't live without them. Also, wherever Sri Ramakrishna is present, Holy Mother as well as the other direct disciples will also be present. If Sri Ramakrishna is worshipped, all of them will be worshipped. Swami Ramakrishnananda, a disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, established this mutt for his South Indian devotees at the behest of Swami Vivekananda. He also brought Holy Mother Sri Sharada Devi to South India for the same purpose. Swami Ramakrishnananda worked extremely hard to spread the message of Sri Ramakrishna in this region. Is it ever possible that Sri Ramakrishna will not stay where Ramakrishnananda established him? He is ever present in this mutt. Whoever calls on him with devotion will get his vision. I want you to come to this mutt and perform spiritual practices here. Meditation and japa performed at this mutt will bring greater results. Do this and see for yourself. Sri Ramakrishna is very much alive at this mutt. Revivify the mutt by your spiritual practices. By this, you and all others will be benefited. It is by seeing you that people will try to understand and attain Sri Ramakrishna. You should lead ideal lives so that more and more people will come to know about the glory of Sri Ramakrishna. This is the responsibility of all the devotees of Sri Ramakrishna, Sri Ma Sharada Devi and Swami Vivekananda. On this auspicious day, let us once again commit ourselves to this sacred duty of Atmano Mokshartham जगत हिताय च। श्री रामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु।